Most people think that the words guilt and shame mean the same thing, but in fact, they are very different, and they bring different outcomes in our lives. Guilt is what Paul called godly sorrow, because it's the feeling we get when we've done something wrong. God uses guilt to bring about repentance in our lives. Repentance means that we agree with God and have come clean about our mistakes. When we repent, we are telling God we don't want to continue doing something unpleasing to Him and are asking Him to help us stop. It doesn't mean we are perfect, but it does mean we have taken action to be right with God. Shame, on the other hand, is worldly sorrow. Shame says there is something wrong with us. Sometimes we heap it on ourselves. Other times it's put on us by others. Shame is unlike guilt in that it doesn't lead us to repentance. Instead of drawing us closer to God, it causes us to walk away from Him. Shame says, you're not good enough. When we do wrong things, God's Spirit will convict us of our wrongdoing. He will lovingly guide us back to a relationship with Him. Once we repent of our sin, He forgives us and the guilt goes away. Christ died for that sin. He covered it. We don't have to hold on to it anymore and feel ashamed.
Sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, oh sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burden. Live.
power in the name of Jesus. break every. There's power. Come on, come on, come on, come on. There is power. Do you believe it? There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power.
I want to talk to you for a few minutes this morning about the king and the fool in you.
Well, I don't know what you mean.
Oh, you will. Resident within you are both of these personalities. You can rule or be a fool. And to illustrate the story, I want to talk to you about David. This week, my little granddaughter asked Tamara, she said, "Mommy, who's your favorite Bible character?" And Tamara thought for a few minutes, and she said, "I think it would be David." And she said, "Mommy, it ought to be Jesus." Out of the mouth of babes. But here's a man after God's own heart. And at the time we look in on the story of the life of David, he has been anointed king. And first, after he's anointed, he just goes back out to the sheepfold and has to do whatever his daddy says. Sometimes we think when God calls us and anoints us, we don't have to listen to anybody. No, that's when you really need to learn to listen and be subject to authority. And as his life is being prepared, if I look at any of the great characters of the Bible, whether it's Moses or Joseph or David, it's not just a fun little ride to where God's taking you. But he is preparing you and building character in you while he's taking you to where you're going. And so David is at a time in his life where he's learning to behave like a king. He's a man after God's own heart, and God has designed that David experience oppression and injustice and prejudice and bitterness and hate and unfair accusations and attack in his life, so that when he gets to the throne, he'll be able to handle it and he'll rule with compassion and wisdom and not just be a dictator. Amen. And so while God is preparing him, he's in a really tight spot. Because his older brother, Eliab, is very jealous, and all of his brothers are jealous because they were passed over and he was anointed king. So his family, he's not on the best terms with his family. Now, I know all of you here are on really good terms with all your relatives, but sometimes God's people aren't at best terms with their own family, okay? The Philistines hate him. He's killed Goliath, their champion warrior. He's defeated them in every battle he's fought with them. They want him dead. King Saul, who he's fighting for and who he refuses to dishonor. No matter what, he won't dishonor Saul. Saul's out to kill him. He gets a chance to get even with Saul. He says, "I'm not going to touch the Lord's anointed." And he ministers mercy. And how many understand he's acting like a king? But sometimes in the process of realizing God has called you to be royal, amen? How many know we're kings and priests according to what Peter says? We forget to act like royalty, and instead of acting wise, we act otherwise. Amen? And so David is at a place in time where Saul is out to kill him, And he gets word that his mentor, his teacher, his spiritual father, his best friend in the world just passed away, the prophet Samuel. And at the death of Samuel, how many understand when you're grieving and you're upset, and how many would admit with me or agree with me that he's in a tight spot here? He's in trouble with Saul and Israel's army. He's in trouble with the Philistines and the Philistines' army. His family's not happy with him. And all of this stuff is going on in his life. And then the one man he can count on, Samuel the prophet, who is his teacher and his mentor, he dies. And an event happens in David's life that causes him to act a little different than a king ought to act. Now, he's not made it to the throne yet, but he's on his way. Tell the person next to you, you haven't made it to the throne yet, but you're on your way. Amen. So that's where we're going to pick up the story in, I almost never use any translation other than the King James from the pulpit, but for the sake of just this being a good story, we're going to 1 Samuel 25 in the New Living Translation. Now, Samuel died, and all of Israel gathered for his funeral, and they buried him in the house of Ramah. And David moved down to the wilderness of Maon. There was a wealthy man from Maon who owned property near the town of Carmel. He had 3,000 sheep and 1,000 goats, and it was sheep shearing time, and the man's name was Nabal, and his wife Abigail was a sensible and beautiful woman. What an awesome combination. I got one of those. Or she has a husband, however it works. Sensible and beautiful. I just like that. But Nabal, descendant of Caleb, was crude and mean in all of his dealings. And when David heard that Nabal was shearing his sheep, he sent 10 of his young men to Carmel with a message for Nabal. Peace and prosperity to you and your family and everything you own. I'm told that it's sheep shearing time, and while your shepherds stayed among us near Carmel, we never harmed them. There was nothing ever stolen from them. In other words, we protected them and we were there for them. Ask your own men. They'll tell you this is true. So be kind to us. Since we've come at a time of celebration, please share any provisions you might have on hand with us, with your friend David. And David's young men gave this message to Nabal in David's name. And they waited for a reply. Who is this fellow David? Nabal sneered to the young men. Who does this son of Jesse think he is? There are lots of servants these days who run away from their masters. Should I take my bread and my water and my meat that and I've slaughtered for my shears and give it to this band of outlaws who comes from who knows where? So David's young men returned and told him what Nabal said. And David said, get your swords. And he strapped on his own, and 400 men started off with David, and 200 remained behind with their equipment. Point number one, a fool will bring out the fool in you. I think it was Lincoln that said it isn't smart to argue with a fool. Listeners can't tell the difference. David has behaved himself so wisely in not shedding the blood of Saul and protecting Israel and handling all the rejection and everything. But all of a sudden, he's grieving, he's upset, everything has gone wrong in his life, and all he wants is a good meal for his men who has protected this man's flocks all these time. And the man says, no way, you're not getting nothing from me. And David loses it. Who's he think he is? I'll just show him. We're just going to go kill them all. Now, this is out of David's character. But you see, sometimes when you're on your way to becoming a king, things happen in your life that make you act like a fool. Now, maybe not you, but every now and again, somebody pulls out in front of me with sign language. Hand signals. And there's a fool that rises up inside of me. How many know sometimes relatives are relatively able to bring out the fool in you? There are situations in life where if you're not careful, how many's ever really been doing good, living for God, and you've overcome these great big trials, and somebody says or does some little stupid thing, and the fool in you shows up? Huh? If you're not admitting it, you're just not being honest.
And so the thing I've got to learn to do as a child of God, if I'm going to reign with Christ, I've got to realize that there's some things in me that I don't always, you know, here's a West Virginia lie. Don't ever believe this lie. I've heard it said here. Well, if you're going to think it, you might as well say it. Oh, no. Lord, have mercy. If everything that ran through here came out here, even when I'm up here, I'd be in trouble. Set a guard over my mouth. Oh, Lord. And David is just so ticked. Meanwhile, one of Nabal's servants went to Abigail and told her, David sent messengers from the wilderness to greet our master. He just screamed insults at him. These men have been good to us. We never suffered any harm from them. Nothing was stolen from us the whole time they were with us. In fact, night and day, they were a wall of protection to us and the sheep. You need to know this and figure out what to do, because there's going to be trouble. Tell the person next to you, there's going to be trouble. For our master and his whole family, he's so ill-tempered, nobody can even talk to him. Uh-oh. Abigail wasted no time. She gathered 200 loaves of bread, 2 wineskins full of wine, 5 sheep that had been slaughtered, a bushel of roasted grain, 100 clusters of raisins, 200 fig cakes, and packed them on donkeys. Said, go on ahead and I'll follow you shortly. But she did not tell her husband Nabal what she was doing. As she was riding her donkey to the mountain ravine, she saw David and his men coming down the mountain toward her. And David had been saying, "Lot of good that did me to help this fella. We protected his flocks in the wilderness. Nothing he owned was lost or stolen. He's repaid me evil for good. May God strike me and kill me if every man of his household is still alive by tomorrow morning." King James uses a much more descriptive term for man of his household, but I'll leave that alone. Some of you Bible scholars know what that is. See, David allowed himself to be a reflection of what he hated. Did you hear me? I'll say that again. David allowed himself to become a reflection of what he hated. He saw Nabal acting like a fool and being stingy and short-tempered and hateful. And instead of him rising above it, he started acting like him. Do you know that'll happen to you? Do you know if somebody hateful gets in your face, you have the ability, and a matter of fact, it is a natural thing to mirror whatever happens to you. That's what they did to me. I'll just show them. You know that's why a smile is so important? How many know somebody smiles a genuine smile at you, you automatically smile back? If nobody smiled at you in this church today, and nobody was friendly with you, nobody? Maybe you ought to get your little hand mirror out and ask yourself, how did I come in here? Because if you come in here with a leave me alone attitude, and you wonder why everybody leaves you alone, I'm going to get in trouble. The Greek word for fool is moron. How about that? And foolish thinking is morologia. So you think like a moron sometimes. Sometimes we know better, but we just act like fools. And here's one. The way of Proverbs 12:15. The way of a fool is right in his own eyes, but he that hearkens to counsel is wise. Now, let's be honest. We always think it's the other fellow. We're in the right. We're not wrong. If they'd have been different, it'd have been okay. You know, if you always think it's everybody but you, that you kind of fit this description here. Now, Pastor, be careful. The Bible said don't call anyone a fool. I ain't calling you nothing, but if the shoe fits, put it on tied up. Huh? You still love me? Listen to Proverbs 18, 6 and 7. Lips of a fool bring them strife. Their mouths invite a beating. The mouth of a fool is his own undoing. Their lips are a snare to their very lives. King James says their mouth calls for strokes. My dad used to tell me, son, you're asking for it. What? What? He soon would show me. He would demonstrate what I had been asking for. And sometimes it's no different. I've seen people just let your mouth fly off without thinking twice and act like a total idiot. And I've been guilty myself. I'm preaching to me too. There have been times when I should have acted like a king and instead I acted like a fool. And David has really lost it here. He has really, and he is so angry. But now before you condemn David, ask yourself, how might you react if you were in the same circumstances he was in? He's just so tired. Anybody ever just get tired of doing the right thing? No, surely not. Obviously we do, or the scriptures would not say, don't be weary in doing right. There are times when I just want to, okay, I know how I'm supposed to do this, but God, can I please just do it my way this time? Amen. I'll repent afterwards. Problem with that kind of repentance, Pastor, is it's usually not real sincere. Amen. Oh, I'm just going to do what I'm going to do, and then I'm going to repent. Now watch this. Don't be weary in doing right, for in due season you will reap if you faint not. See, David's done right for a long time. He's gritted his teeth. He's been respectful to Saul. He's listened to his father and been respectful, even though his brothers are jealous of him. They made fun of him even when he went to try to kill the giant. And he's done it right, and he's done it right, and he's done it right. And now he's broke. He's disgusted. He's grieving. He's lost his best friend and his mentor. And since Samuel ain't there to straighten him out, he's just going to do it his way. But thank God for a woman with some sense. Some of you husbands need to turn to your wife right now and say, thank you for the times you stopped me from acting like a fool. And vice versa. Amen. Okay. How many has ever acted like a fool when you found out somebody said something about you they shouldn't have? How dare they talk about me like that, as if you're better than Jesus or something. Amen? How many know it hurts when you tried your best to do what was right, though, and you get right? You know, and that's why Paul warns. David feels like, I've been doing it right all this time, and what's it got me? So now I'm going to do it my way. You've never been there, but boy, I have. Okay? Second point I want to give you is wisdom will speak to the king in you just like a fool brings out the fool in you. Amen. I want you to hear this. Getting even is not justice. Well, it's just what they deserve. Oh, no. What if God gave you what you deserved? Now, I know some of you think you deserve all these wonderful accolades and awards, but what we all deserve is hell, was it not for the grace of God and the sacrifice of Christ on the cross? So Abigail begins to speak to him. And she comes to him, and Abigail saw David. She quickly got off her donkey and bowed low before him, and she fell at his feet and said, I'll accept the blame in this matter. She didn't say, I'm guilty. She just said, I'll accept the blame. My Lord, please listen to what I have to say. I know Nabal is a wicked, ill-tempered man. Please don't pay attention to him. He's a fool, just as his name suggests. His name literally means fool. Why would you name your kid that? Well, never mind. Now, none of you have ever wanted to tell your kids, you're such an idiot. You've never wanted to do that, I'm sure. You shouldn't, but okay. Now, watch what she says here. Just as his name suggests, I never saw the young man that you sent. Now, my Lord, as surely as the Lord lives and you yourself live, since the Lord has kept you from murdering and taking vengeance into your own hands, let all your enemies and those who try to harm you be as cursed as Nabal is. And here is a present that I, your servant, have brought to you and your young men. Please forgive me if I have offended you in any way. Now, I want you to notice something. She says something here. God's kept you from committing injustice this far. How many thank God what he's kept you from doing this far? Amen. Your kids are still alive, right? Amen. Come on, don't look at me in that old self-righteous way. She said, God's protected you and kept you from doing wrong this far. Don't mess up now. Now, I'm going to give you some A, B's, and C's. That's A. God's kept you from committing injustice this far, so trust Him now. B, I want you to see this. Your actions reflect on the Lord that you serve. She's talking to the king in him now. Watch what she says. The Lord will surely reward you with a lasting dynasty. You are fighting the Lord's battles, and you have done no wrong throughout your entire life. Wow. Don't forget, David, that right now you're wanting to settle the score for yourself. But God's called you to something higher, to fight His battles. What words of wisdom from Abigail. Can I share that with you this morning? You may want to avenge yourself and just turn inward when things go wrong to you and just pity yourself, but God has called you to a higher calling than avenging yourself. If you fight your own battles, God will step back and let you lose. But if you realize, I'm going to stand still, see the salvation of God, let God take care of this situation in my life because I'm fighting His battles. I've got a bigger fight. How many believe we're the army of God? Have we sung about it all morning? We've got a bigger battle to fight than to go around trying to always take up for ourselves. Amen. Amen. You're going to be offended. Things are going to happen aren't right. I know that. But listen, we got to remember, we can't run around. David is detouring from what he's called to do to fight God's battles, to fight a little battle of his own that would have destroyed his testimony in front of others. How many know when we act like a fool, we destroy our testimony in the kingdom? Okay, do you get that, B? Your actions reflect on the Lord you serve. C, God holds you as His special treasure. I want you to notice the wisdom of how she speaks to Him. Even when you are chased by those who seek to kill you, Saul and the Philistines, your life is safe in the care of the Lord your God, secure in His treasure pouch. Isn't that awesome? She said, God's holding you right next to His heart, in the palm of His hand. You're His special treasure. And those who have tried to kill you haven't been successful this far because God's got you in His hand. And then knowing how He loves to use a slingshot, she says this. It's a wise woman. But your enemies will disappear like stones shot from a sling. How many thank God that you don't have to act like a fool because you are royalty and you are God's special treasure. You know, that's the same words that Peter uses in telling us that we're kings and priests. He says we're a peculiar people, which doesn't mean peculiar like I act. It means a special treasure to God. Aren't you glad you're God's special treasure? Tell the person next to you, you're too much royalty to act like that. Amen. D. How many is ready for point for D? God has destined you to reign, she says. So begin with reigning over the fool in you. Amen? I'm going to say that again. She didn't say begin with reigning over the fool in you, but that's what I'm saying. How many believe we're destined to reign in this life? God has given us authority spiritually. Satan has to back off when a child of God who knows who he is in Christ says, I bind you in the name of Jesus. Demons have to flee. We should have authority in our families, in our homes, as the kingdom of God. So if we're going to reign, let's begin by reigning over the fool that resides in us. Amen. When the Lord, listen to what she says here, when the Lord has done all He has promised and made you leader over Israel, don't let this be a blemish on your record. Then your conscience won't have to bear the staggering burden of needless bloodshed and vengeance when the Lord has done these great things for you. Please remember me, your servant. Wow. God's got a destiny for you. I wonder if we learn as parents to talk to our kids this way. And speak to the king in them. God's got plans for you. The enemy wants to destroy you, make you act like an idiot, make you destroy your future. But God's got plans for you. I wonder what would have happened if Abigail had showed up like this and said, you're just as big as an idiot as Nabal. You're acting just like him. Why do you have to act like an idiot all the time? Wouldn't that have brought out the king in him? Huh? Would that have brought, now come on, answer me. Would that have brought out the king in him? Can't believe you're acting like a fool again. then how come you ladies think it's going to bring out the king or the prince in your husband when you talk to him that way? Talk to the fool in him. You'll probably see more of it. Talk to the king in him. Hey, you're a good man. And I know you're a better man than that. And the same husbands with your wives. Talk to the fool in her or talk to the queen in her. Amen. How are you going to answer it? What are you going to speak? If Abigail had just showed up telling him he was acting like a total idiot, and why did he have to act? Most guys were that way. That's just the way men are. She could have said all that. I watch when you say amen. But instead, she spoke to the king in him. How many believe it'd be good if we learned to speak to the king and the queen and our brothers and sisters in the kingdom of God? Amen. And see the qualities that God has placed in them. Somebody said, well, Pastor, you don't see the wrong that some people do. You just brag on the good that they do. Listen, I want to speak to the king in them. I want to encourage the good. I believe that it's good to build people up and encourage them. Yeah, we don't ignore wrong. We know when there's wrong done. But let me tell you something. Always telling somebody that everything they're doing is wrong will never, ever, ever speak to the king in them. I so enjoyed getting this message. It just blessed me. And it showed me that I need to reign over my own spirit. Okay? Proverbs 25:28 says this. He that has no rule over his own spirit is like a city that's broken down and without walls. If you just get mad or sad or glad at the influence of everybody around you, and you have no self-control over your own emotions, the Bible says you would just be like, how many remember when the walls of Jericho fell? It was no problem to take over the city. In the days that this was written, there wasn't Star Wars and missile defenses. There were walls around the city. Listen, build a wall of self-control through the Holy Spirit. How many know that's part of the fruit of the Spirit? Around yourself, you don't have to give in to every impulse and act like a fool. Amen. David replied to Abigail, "Praise the Lord God of Israel who sent you to meet me today. Thank God for your good sense. Bless you for keeping me from murder and carrying out vengeance with my own hands. For I swear by the Lord God of Israel who's kept me from hurting you, if you hadn't hurried out to meet me, not one of Nabal's men would still be alive by tomorrow morning." And David accepted her presence and told her, "Return home in peace. I've heard what you said. We won't kill your husband." Anybody remember Paul Harvey and the rest of the story? Let me give you the rest of the story. Nabal's been having a big party and he's just been out of his mind drunk. You know, people never change. Technology may change, but people still do the same crazy things they've always done. He's having this big party and he's all lit up and half wasted, and he's awake the next morning with a hangover. And he looks around and finds Abigail, and she said, guess what I did last night? There's a reason why you're still alive. I went and saved your life. He got so mad that his blood pressure shot up. Now, I know that don't happen to anybody in here. His blood pressure shot up so high that he had a stroke. And 10 days later, he died. And David found out about it, and David got his little parchment out and his pen, and he wrote, "Dear Abby." "Sorry to hear about the death of your husband." Oh, I can't. The Holy Spirit spoke to him, because, you know, this same David that's going down there, "I'm going to kill every last one of them." Just a few minutes before, we're singing, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures." Oh God, you're so precious. I love you. I worship you. Nabal said, "What?" How many's ever been in worship and on the way home from church acted like a fool? Come on, be real. So he, "Well, I can't write. Sorry to hear about the death of your husband. Condolences in your grieving." Well, no. What are you doing next Friday night, Abby? How many know he married her? Hey, wise counselor, good looking. That was the king in him. Amen. So folks, keep it in mind this morning that you have resident within you a king and a fool. And while you look at the person next to you and think, I know which one you're acting like, I want to ask you in closing, will you speak this week coming to the king or to the fool in each other? Imagine the tragic differences if Abigail would have shown up and just berated him and dishonored him because of the way he was behaving. But hear this, ladies and gentlemen, even in his foolish rage, she honored the king in him, and it stopped him and turned him around. That's just an incredible story, isn't it? Have you ever wanted to say, you're such an idiot? This is why Jesus says in the New Testament, don't do that. Didn't he? Call no man a fool. I've looked at things that my kids have done, and I've thought of all the stupid things. Huh? Now, if you're saying you never would talk to your kids that way, they're probably not teenagers yet. Huh? But you know what? I had a dad that found out there was a way to evict the fool from me. Foolishness is bound in the heart of a child, but the rod of correction will drive it far from him. You know, he dealt with the fool in me. But you know what? He didn't kill it because he still shows up every now and again. So we're laughing. But I'm going to tell you something. How many understand that this little message has the potential to change your life forever? And not only yours, but the fellowship in this church, do we speak to the king in each other or the fool in each other? Your relationship with your husband and your wife, ladies and gentlemen, how do you speak to each other? Do you encourage the king or speak to the fool? Amen. Amen. Stand with me. Have you ever been so down, as David must have been at this time, that you even wondered if there really was a God? Huh? Come on, let's be honest. Anybody say, oh God, are you, that's the fool in you. The fool has said in his heart, not out loud, there is no God. You say, Pastor, why are you bringing that to your attention? Because that fella is called a lot of different names in the Bible. A lot of times in the New Testament, it's just called the flesh, right? Amen? But he's in there. Here's what I don't want you to do. Because he's in there, I don't want you to give up and say, well, I'm just such a fool. I'll never amount to anything. No. You say, I have the nature of Christ in me. I have the divine nature. I'm a child of the king. I'm destined to reign with him. I'm a prince. I'm a king. I'm a king. Tell the person next to you, I am royalty in training. Amen. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for your word this morning. May your word be a lamp to our feet, a light to our path. We'll hide these words in your heart. God, may we realize that we have the ability, this week coming, we're going to have the ability, before this day is over, I'd venture to say, to either act like a prince or a fool. And we ask you, Father, that the Holy Spirit would speak to the king and the queen and each person in this place today. That would speak to the king in us, Father, that we would live like you'd have us to live and act like you'd have us to act. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Praise God. The altar's open.